Hello, my name is Carlo Benedetto Cimento. I come from Italy and I'm a conductor. Today, I'm here with Professor Frischenschlager discussing about one of the most interesting topics in classical music. Orchestral conducting is a difficult subject. It's not only about a physical movement. It's an art which lives of experiences of orchestras, musicians, singers, and conductors. Professor Frischenschlager was playing in one of the best orchestras in the world. He's a fantastic teacher, fantastic musician, but above all, he's a sensitive, intelligent, and profound person. For this reason, I'm really looking forward to our conversation. Thank you, Professor.
Yes, I'm looking forward too.
I would like to start talking about the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra. How did your experience start and how would you describe it?
Yes, in 1961, I came from Cologne where I had a scholarship. I came to Vienna because I wanted to study in Vienna at the academy, that it was called academy. When I came there, I had already three diplomas, two from Salzburg and one from Cologne. It was so-called concert examen. My teacher in Vienna, this was Professor Samuhil, he immediately proposed me for an audition with the Vienna Philharmonic. And I had already a bit experience with orchestra. I had played with the Mozarteum Orchestra a few times, and I had played with the Kamerate Akademiker in Salzburg and with the Rheinische Kammerorchester. But it was not really a lot of experience. And for me, when I came to Vienna, it was exciting to make audition for the Vienna Philharmonic, proposed by my teacher, my wonderful teacher. And I was so lucky to be accepted, as it was called, it doesn't exist anymore, a ständiger Substitut. This meant this was created for young, advanced students, or postgraduate students, and it gave them the possibility to play in the opera, to play in the concerts, and to also sometimes make the disc recordings with the orchestra. And now, arriving in Vienna and having the chance to play in the Vienna Philharmonic, I remember that it was something like a shock to play in this wonderful orchestra. I never forget that. The first times I was sitting there in the first violins, I was so impressed, the incredible intensity, the incredible musicianship. All these sometimes quite old violinists, they play how they played, with so much intensity, so much joy. And they have played it already perhaps many years. But still, there was this great love for their work in the orchestra and for the music they were playing. This was for me a great, great experience.
Of course, it was for you an incredible occasion and possibility to work with the best conductors of the time. With whom did you play, for example?
Yes, this is quite a long list. There was Klemperer, the old Klemperer. There was Karajan, there was Böhm. There was Josef Krips, I loved very much, especially when he conducted Mozart. And there was Mitropoulos, as you said, the most important conductors of the time. And this was, of course, stimulating, and one could learn a lot of them. So, I remember we admired so much Mitropoulos. Mitropoulos once told us, he was from Greece, that in his school, it was a monastery school, they had every day training for memory, very, very hard. And this, he said, this was his training that now helps him so much conducting, to know everything, really to remember everything by heart.
Maybe I should go to a monastery too.
Maybe. Yeah, in Greece.
In Greece?
Yeah.
A bad idea. And of course, you did a lot of concerts, beautiful concerts, but do you remember one in particular?
There were several concerts which were particular, but there was one concert that was really touching for me. This was a Philharmonic matinee with Klemperer. It was not long before his death, but still I was happy to be able to play in this concert under his baton. And what was incredible is that he was too weak to move. He conducted the orchestra almost by his eyes. And it was like hypnosis. Everybody in the orchestra looked at him, and there was an intensity and concentration, and everybody felt what he felt. And it was the unfinished 10th Mahler. So this is, for me, a very precious memory.
Thank you. The Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra is famous for its traditions, in particular for Mozart and the New Year's concert. Which is for you the best Mozart conductor, and did you ever play in this New Year's concert?
Yes, both. The first question I must answer that for me, I love to play Mozart with Karl Böhm and with Josef Krebs. For them, they felt Mozart more than any other conductor for me of that time. But it's just my personal impression. I loved to play under them, the Mozart, whatever it was. The New Year's concert, this is something perhaps I should tell you. The New Year's concert in that time, in the 60s, was totally different from our time. I was happy in the whole orchestra. This New Year's concert in the 60s was like a family meeting, musical meeting of the Vienna Philharmonic with their audience from Vienna. Everybody enjoyed it. It was a very relaxed and very happy feeling in the hall and on the stage. And there was some very different thing. There was no conductor. There was no conductor. There was the concertmaster, you don't know his name, Billy Boskowski. He was then, for many years, was concertmaster. And our New Year's concert at that time was that the concertmaster, like Johann Strauss, was ahead with the violin.
Leading the orchestra.
No, but he was on the place, he stand up, he stood up, but with the violin, conducting, playing. It was such a intimate atmosphere. And for me today, of course, we know it's a great event, it's a great television event around the world, but it's much different. Today it is a big symphony concert, practically, with some famous conductor. And this is the big difference to then. I played only 4 years, in the 60 to 64. This went on still some time, but then became the New Year's concert became a very important show event. And so that's the difference. Of course, they play wonderfully also today. It was different.
Are there conductors you particularly admired, but with whom you didn't play?
Yeah, of course, there were my two gods among the conductors. This is Wilhelm Furtwängler. I was young. I have heard him conducting Don Giovanni at the Salzburg Festspielhaus, and I was excited, and I was so touched. And this, yes, belongs to my most important memories. Musical memories of in opera or concert. And Furtwängler was the last great representant of the old great German Romantic school. And his conducting was so full of emotion, and he transported what he felt so intensively to the orchestra. It was very famous that his conducting technique was it's a bit chaotic, but he took away the orchestra and along his ideas and his wonderful ideas as musician. There was a famous saying among the Philharmonic orchestra, because Furtwängler always was famous to make the upbeat moving like this.
Going down.
Going down, yes. And so the orchestra was asked by a journalist, a critic, when Furtwängler makes this, how do you know when to have to start? There was a famous answer, when we lose the patience. But Furtwängler for me was great, great. And then another one later, this is Carlos Kleiber. He has an incredibly deep musicality and a sense of colors and a musical sensitivity, which is really unique. He was a difficult person, it's well known, but as musician, he was, for me, the greatest musician as conductor in the second half of the 20th century. And all concerts I have seen with him were for me a really enormous event, musical event. I felt so much and was grateful for any concert I could hear with him. I remember the New Year's concert, for instance. I don't know when it was. This was such a fantastic atmosphere. And this, because this music is great music, we know, no? Johann Strauss. And he made it in such a classical and still so warm and still light atmosphere.
He had this particular talent for this music, I think. So this perfume in his
for colors and for atmosphere. Yeah, it was great.
Dear Professor, I know you didn't work much under Karajan, but that you have quite a common past, and that you know some interesting details about the young Karajan in particular. Can you tell us?
So the common past with Karajan is my father, because my father, as teacher at the Mozarteum for theory, he was teacher of Karajan. And my father was also kind of friend with the father of Karajan, who was a famous doctor in Salzburg. And so sometimes very special things arrived. I could hear and knew. So I remember, for instance, Karajan as a young student was almost a child prodigy on piano. He played with 16 years. He played with the Mozarteum Orchestra, the Liszt concerto, and with great success. But he always, being a young pianist, wanted to become conductor. And my father told us the story that he tried to convince Karajan to continue the career as pianist. And he said to him, as he told us, "Well, Herbert, you know that the conductors we have around who have no orchestra and who are desperate for this are so many." And Karajan, 16 years old, said to Professor Frischenschlager, to my father, "Yes, Professor, but I will go over them." And so it seems already 16 years, he has a strong will. No? And what was so typical, also in young, a student, that he knew exactly what he wanted. And every movement, everything was in this direction. Karajan, when he studied, still a student, he knew, and this was somehow new, no? Because with Karajan begins this period of this somehow show, as not only the music, also the picture for the audience is
from
important.
Behind.
Yes, and so this I also knew from the family that he trained in a very dark room, just with the lights on him, for a big mirror, to train how it looks, to train the movements. And also for this reason, he took lessons with the that time very famous dancer, Kreuzberg, and just to train himself to be wonderful to look as conductor, not only what comes out from the orchestra. Yeah, this was typical for him.
And how was he working, for example, with the Vienna Philharmonic?
Oh, as conductor, he was very kind, never loud, but he had a very personal aura. For me, it was not a musical aura. It was the personality.
Personal aura.
A great, strong personality. And this, of course, is one of the most important things for a conductor, to have this aura. His musical aura for me was mainly for the big romantic repertoire, Verdi, and whatever it is. Vienna classic music, he made a lot of discs, and they are all wonderful, but they don't touch me. But this is my personal meaning, I cannot dare. Yeah, and I remember also when because he knew me from Salzburg and as student, and when I played in the orchestra, because I wanted to become conductor myself for a period. And so I always looked at him, how he's doing and so matter. And once he said to me, don't always look at me, look at the music.
That's interesting.
Yes, yes. Because I was fascinating. He was fascinating as conductor. Not always as musician for me. Yeah, but this is personal.
We are here for your personal opinion.
Yes, perhaps.
Now I would like to talk about conducting in general. What does being a conductor mean for you?
Well, I think being a conductor is the fascinating profession to perform the wonderful music for orchestra. For me, a conductor must be always a leader through knowledge, a leader through artistic quality when he is before the orchestra. He has to feel always as primus inter pares. And it's well known that the musicians in the orchestra like to say, the Vienna Philharmonic, the Berlin Philharmonic, this one doesn't hear. And one can easily say it is perhaps right, because the gesture doesn't sound. The gesture, through the personality behind the gesture, a great performance of a masterpiece of music.
Yeah. And I know you wanted to be a conductor yourself, you said it before. Did you study, or where did you study? And
yes, my main goal was violinist. But then there was a time I was thinking I could be also conductor. And so I attended conducting classes in Salzburg, in Cologne, in Wien, Swarovski, but not for a long time, because I began to feel that I am not the right personality. I don't have the right character to be a good conductor. Perhaps I have the musicality, but I am not the right person. And so I gave it up, the idea, and I turned back to the violin. And I remember also this experience that I was sometimes conducting in master classes and somewhere in the school orchestra, and always felt this great contrast. I had such a strong idea about the music, and to compare what I was hearing, the difference was too...
From the orchestra,
the difference was too big. And I despaired somehow that one will never arrive. I understood the good conductor know this, and they find a compromise. But then I thought, in any case, better to stay at home and to practice on the violin until it's so perfect as I love it, I like it, and then it's easier than to try with an orchestra to find this compromise, which is still a good performance, but never as you imagine the music. Mm. Therefore, then, I remained with the violin.
You named Swarovski. He was this famous teacher in the Vienna University. He created this super famous school and important school till now. How was it? How was the lesson with him?
Yes, Swarovski as conductor was totally intellectual. He was a great analytic, how do you say? He studied the music in his own system, analyzing it to the perfection. But I have played under him too, and as conductor on the stage, he didn't touch, he didn't. It was, and in the opera, I remember that was, I shouldn't say it perhaps, but there was always a kind of problem between orchestra because he was not flexible enough. But he was absolutely a great teacher. He was a great pedagogue, and he trained the students to think about what they are conducting, to analyze it, and from this to start the interpretation, not the performance. This was his great quality.
By the way, students and teachers, what would you suggest to a young conductor?
Well, it's nothing special. I would really advise to study very, very hard, very, very hard, to arrive as much as possible to the goal of being a professional conductor. And this means it's hard, hard work. And another thing I really would advise young conductors to remember always the great responsibility they have to keep the heritage of the wonderful classical music in their work, in their whole life as musicians. And I think the young conductors of our time should always remember the enormous responsibility they have for the future of our wonderful classical music.
Thank you, Professor.